Hello, my name is Richard Wilde. This is Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy by Douglas Adams. We are currently on chapter 30. We're going to read 30, 31 next week because we're so very near the end. It's going to be a 3-chapter special. Let's begin. Chapter 30. So there you have it, said Slarty Bartfast, making a feeble and perfunctory attempt to clear away some of the appalling mess of his study. He picked up a piece of paper from the top of a pile, but then couldn't think of anywhere else to put it, so he put it back on top of the original pile, which promptly fell over. Deep thought designed the earth, we built it and you lived on it. And the Vogons came and destroyed it 5 minutes before the programme was completed, added Arthur, not unbitterly. Yes, said the old man, pausing to gaze hopelessly round the room. 10 million years of planning and work gone just like that. 10 million years, Earthman. Can you conceive of that kind of time span? A galactic civilization could grow from a single worm 5 times over that time. Gone. He paused. Well, that's bureaucracy for you, he added. You know, said Arthur thoughtfully, all this explains a lot of things. All my life, I've had this strange, unaccountable feeling that something was going on in the world. Something big, even sinister, and no one would tell me what it was. No, said the old man, that's just perfectly normal paranoia. Everyone in the universe has that. Everyone, said Arthur. Well, if everyone has that, perhaps it means something. Perhaps somewhere outside the universe we know. Maybe, who cares? Said Slarty Bartfast before Arthur got too excited. Perhaps I'm old and tired, he continued, but I always think that chances of finding out what's really going on are so absurdly remote that the only thing to do is to hang the sense of it and keep yourself occupied. Look at me. I design coastlines. I've got an award for Norway. He rummaged around in a pile of debris and pulled out a large Perspex box with his name on it and a model of Norway moulded into it. Where's the sense in that? He said. None that I've been able to make out. I've been doing fjords all my life. For a fleeting moment they became fashionable and I'll get a major award. He turned it over in his hands with a shrug and tossed it aside carelessly, but not so carelessly that it didn't land on something soft. In this replacement earth we're building, they're giving me Africa to do, and of course I'm doing it all with old fjords again, because I happen to like them, and I'm old-fashioned enough to think they give a lovely Baroque feel to a continent. And they tell me it's not equatorial enough. Equatorial! He gave a hollow laugh. What does it matter? Science achieved some wonderful things, of course, but I'd far rather be happy than right any day. And are you? No, that's where it all falls down, of course. Pity, said Arthur, with sympathy. Sounded like quite a good lifestyle otherwise. Somewhere on the wall, a small white light flashed. Come, said Slarty Bartfast. You were to meet the mice. Your arrival on the planet has caused considerable excitement. It's already been hailed, so I gather, as the third most improbable event in the history of the universe. What were the first two? Oh, probably just coincidences, said Slarty Bartfast carelessly. He opened the door and stood, waiting for Arthur to follow. Arthur glanced around him once more, and then down at himself at the sweaty, dishevelled clothes he'd been lying in the mud in on Thursday morning. I seem to be having tremendous difficulty with my lifestyle, he muttered to himself. I beg your pardon, said the old man mildly. Oh, nothing, said Arthur. Only joking. Chapter 31. It is, of course, well known that careless talk costs lives, but the full scale of the problem is not always appreciated. For instance, at the very moment that Arthur said, I seem to be having tremendous difficulty with my lifestyle, a freak wormhole opened up in the fabric of the space-time continuum and carried his words far, far back in time across almost infinite reaches of space to a distant galaxy where strange and warlike beings were poised on the brink of frightful interstellar battle. the two opposing leaders were meeting for the last time, a dreadful silence fell across the conference table as the commander of the Vlhergs, resplendent in his black, jeweled battle shawls, gazed levelly at the Gugvunt leader squatting opposite him in a cloud of green, sweet-smelling steam. With a million sleek and horribly beweaponed star cruisers poised to unleash electric death at his single word of command, challenged the vile creature to take back what it had said about his mother. The creature stirred in its sickly broiling vapour, and at that very moment the words, "I seem to be having tremendous difficulty with my lifestyle," drifted across the conference table. Unfortunately, in the Vlherg tongue, this was the most dreadful insult imaginable, and there was nothing for it but to wage terrible war for centuries. Eventually, of course, after their galaxy had been decimated over a few thousand years, it was realised that the whole thing had been a ghastly mistake, and so the two opposing battle fleets settled their differences. Oh, I've lost my point. Settled their few remaining differences in order to launch a joint attack on our own galaxy, now positively identified as the source of the offending remark. For thousands more years, the mighty ships tore across the empty wastes of space and finally dived screaming onto the first planet they came across, which happened to be the Earth, where due to a terrible miscalculation of scale, the entire battle fleet was accidentally swallowed by a small dog. Those who study the complex interplay of cause and effect in the history of the universe say that this sort of thing is going on all the time, but that we are powerless to prevent it. It's just life, they say. A short air car trip brought Arthur and the old Magrathean to a doorway. They left the car and went through the door into a waiting room full of glass-topped tables and Perspex awards. Almost immediately, a light flashed above the door at the other side of the room, and they entered. "Arthur, you're safe," a voice cried. "Am I?" said Arthur, rather startled. "Oh, good." The lighting was rather subdued, and it took him a moment or so to see Ford, Trillian and Zaford sitting round a large table, beautifully decked out with exotic dishes, strange sweetmeats and bizarre fruits. They were stuffing their faces. "What happened to you?" demanded Arthur. "Well," said Seyfod, attacking a bone full of grilled mussel, "our guests here have been gassing us and zapping our minds and being generally weird, and have now given us a rather nice meal to make it up to us. Here," he said, hoiking out a lump of evil-smelling meat from a bowl, "have some vegan rhino's cutlet. It's delicious if you happen to like that sort of thing."
"Hosts," said Arthur.
"What hosts? I don't see any," a small boy said.
"Welcome to lunch, Earth creature."
Arthur glanced round and suddenly yelped. "Ugh!" he said. "There are mice on the table." There was an awkward silence as everybody looked pointedly at Arthur. He was busy staring at two white mice sitting in what looked like whiskey glasses on the table. He heard the silence and glanced round at everyone. "Oh," he said with sudden realisation. "Oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't quite prepared for..." "Let me introduce you," said Trillian. "Arthur, this is Benji Mouse."
"Hi,"
said one of the mice. His whiskers stroked what must have been a touch-sensitive panel on the inside of the whiskey glass-like affair, and it moves forward slightly. "And this is Frankie Mouse," the other mouse said.
"Pleased to meet you,"
and did likewise. Arthur gaped. "But aren't they..." "Yes," said Trillian. "They are the mice I brought with me from Earth." She looked him in the eye, and Arthur thought... he detected the tiniest resigned shrug. "Could you pass me that bowl of grated Arcturian mega donkey?" she said. Slartibart Fuzz coughed politely.
"Excuse me," he said.
"Yes, you, thank you, Slartibart Fuzz," said Benji Mouse sharply. "You may go."
"What?
Oh, very well," said the old man, slightly taken aback. "I'll just, go and get on with some of my fjords, then."
"Ah, well, in fact, that won't be necessary,"
said Frankie Mouse.
"It looks very much as if we won't be needing the new Earth any longer."
He swiveled his pink little eyes.
Not now that we've found a native of the planet who was there seconds before it was destroyed.
What? Cried Slarty Bart Fostergast. You can't mean that. I've got 1,000 glaciers poised and ready to roll over Africa.
Well, perhaps you can take a quick skiing holiday before you dismantle them, said Frankie, acidly.
Skiing holiday? Cried the old man. Those glaciers are works of art. Elegantly sculpted contours, soaring pinnacles of ice, deep, majestic ravines. It will be sacrilege to go skiing on high art.
Thank you, Slarty Bart Fast, said Benji firmly. That will be all.
Yes, sir, said the old man coldly. Thank you very much. Well, goodbye, Earthman, he said to Arthur. Hope the lifestyle comes together. With a brief nod to the rest of the company, he turned and walked sadly out of the room. Arthur stared after him, not knowing what to say.
Now,
said Benji Mouse,
to business.
Ford and Zaphod clinked their glasses together. To business, they said.
I beg your pardon, said Benji.
Ford looked round. Oh, sorry, I thought you were proposing a toast, he said. The two mice scuttled impatiently around in their glass transports. Finally, they composed themselves, and Benji moved forward to address Arthur.
Now, Earth creature, he said, the situation we have, in effect, is this. We have, as you know, been more or less running your planet for the last 10 million years in order to find this wretched thing called the ultimate question.
Why? Said Arthur sharply.
No, we've already thought of that one,
said Frankie. Oops, wrong voice. Interrupting.
But it doesn't fit the answer. Why? 42. You see? It doesn't work.
No, said Arthur. I mean, why have you been doing it?
Oh, I see,
said Frankie.
Well, eventually just habit, I think, to be brutally honest. And this is more or less the point. We're sick to the teeth of the whole thing and the prospect of doing it all over again on account of those win-it-ridden Vogons. Quite frankly, gives me the screaming heebie-jeebies. You know what I mean? It was by the merest lucky chance that Benji and I finished our particular job and left the planet early for a quick holiday and have since manipulated our way back to Magrathea by the good offices of your friends. Magrathea is a gateway back to our own dimension.
It's gone Australian, put in Benji.
Since when?
Continued his marine colleague.
We have had an offer of quite enormously fat contract to do the 5D chat show and lecture circuit back in our own dimensional nick of the woods. We're very much inclined to take it.
I would, wouldn't you? Ford? Said Zaphod promptingly. Oh yeah, said Ford. Jump at it, like a shot. Arthur glanced at them, wondering what all this was leading up to.
But we've got to have product, you see, said Frankie. I mean, ideally, we still need the ultimate question in some form or another.
Zaphod leaned forward to Arthur. You see, he said, if they're just sitting there in the studio looking very relaxed and, you know, just mentioning that they happen to know the answer to life, the universe and everything, and eventually they have to admit, in fact, it is 42, then the show's probably quite short. No follow-up, you see.
We have to have something that sounds good, said Benji.
Something that sounds good, exclaimed Arthur. An ultimate question that sounds good. From a couple of mice, the mice bristled.
Well, I mean, yes, idealism, yes, the dignity of pure research, yes, the pursuit of truth in all its forms, but there comes a point, I'm afraid, where you begin to suspect that if there's any real truth, it's that the entire multi-dimensional infinity of the universe is almost certainly being run by a bunch of maniacs. And if it comes to a choice between spending yet another 10 million years finding that out, and on the other hand, just taking the money and running, then I, for one, could do the exercise,
said Frankie, wrong bleeding mouse voice. Started Arthur, hopelessly. Hey, will you get this, Earthman? Interrupted Zaphod. You are a last-generation product to that computer matrix, right? And you were there right up until the moment your planet got the finger, yeah? So your brain was an organic part of the So your brain was an organic part of the penultimate configuration of the computer program, said Ford, rather lucidly, he thought.
Right? Said Zaphod.
Well, said Arthur doubtfully. He wasn't aware of ever having felt an organic part of anything. He had always seen this as one of his problems.
In other words, said Benji, steering his curious little vehicle right over to Arthur, there's a good chance that the structure of the question is encoded in the structure of your brain, so we want to buy it off you.
What, the question? Said Arthur. Yes, said Ford and Trillium.
For lots of money, said Zaphod.
No, no,
said Frankie.
It's the brain we want to buy.
What?
Well, who would miss it?
Inquired Benji. I thought you said you could just read his brain electronically, protested Ford.
Oh, yeah,
said Frankie.
But we'd have to get it out first. It's got to be prepared. Treated, said Benji. Diced.
Thank you, said Arthur, tipping up his chair and backing away from the table in horror.
Well, it could always be replaced, said Benji reasonably, if you think it's important. Yes, an electronic brain, said Frankie. A simple one would suffice.
A simple one, wailed Arthur.
Yeah, said Zaphod with a sudden evil grin. You just have to program it to say what, and I don't understand, and where's the tea? Who'd know the difference?
What? Cried Arthur, backing away still further. See what I mean? Said Zaphod and howled with pain because something Trillian did at that moment. I'd notice the difference, said Arthur.
No, you wouldn't, said Frankie Mouse. You'd be programmed not to.
Ford made for the door. Look, I'm sorry, my soul lads, he said. I don't think we got a deal.
I rather think we do have a deal,
said the mice in chorus, all the charm vanishing from their piping little voices in an instant. With a tiny whining shriek, their two glass transports lifted themselves off the table and swung through the air towards Arthur, who stumbled further backwards into a blind corner, utterly unable to cope or think of anything. Trillian grabbed him desperately by the arm and tried to drag him towards the door, which Ford and Zaphod were struggling to open, but Arthur was dead weight. He seemed hypnotised by the airborne robot swooping towards him. She screamed at him, but he just gaped. With one more yank, Ford and Zaphod got the door open. On the other side of it was a small pack of rather ugly men, who he could only assume was the heavy mob of Magrathea. Not only were they ugly themselves, but the medical equipment they carried with them was also far from pretty. They charged. So Arthur was about to have his head cut open. Trillian was unable to help him, and Ford and Zaphod were about to be set upon by several thugs a great deal heavier and more sharply armed than they were. All in all, it was extremely fortunate that at that moment, every alarm on the planet burst into an ear-splitting din. Don't panic.